Thank you, Art. Well, good evening. Friends, it is a joy to be with you this evening as we turn now from the great mandate Jesus calling to us as his people to love one another to the shadows of the cross. Why do we call this Good Friday? What could possibly be good about today? Jesus' disciples had abandoned him. The Pharisees, the religious leaders, had seemingly won and defeated their arch enemy in Jesus. Even the power of evil seemingly won. What could be good about today? And yet, something would happen, something monumental that would change the fate of all human history. Something would happen on the cross for us. And so we must make, as Robert Weber puts it, we must make the journey into death with Christ. And this evening, we're going to join with each other and with Jesus and walk towards the shadow of the cross. Be reminded once again of the death of Christ that leads us to the hope of resurrection and the hope of Easter morning. So friends, will you turn your hearts in worship on this day, this good day, this hard day, but this important day, this Good Friday? Let us pray. Father in heaven, as we turn our hearts to you, help us to look to the cross and to see Christ once again in the fullness of his glory and his love for each of us, for all of humanity, for all of creation. Would you join with us in this worship hour, and would your Spirit speak and move in us as we prepare our hearts for Easter morning? Speak, act, move, we ask, as you lead us into the shadow of the cross. And all God's people said, amen.
Shadows. The place where light and darkness meet. Where light is obstructed. The prophet Isaiah wrote, "The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the shadow of death, a light has dawned. And yet, against the light of the manger, the shadow of a cross was already forming. The light was shining, but the darkness could not understand it. The shadows began to gather. Jesus stood above Jerusalem. He saw a shadow of turning descending on the city and wept. As he entered her gates, the cheers of the people mingled with the jeers of his accusers. The man of sorrows looked deeper into the darkness and heard the hosannas quickly turning to cries of crucify."
Oh,
Evening came, and the disciples gathered around their master for the Passover feast. While they were eating, Jesus made a startling revelation. "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." Each of them began to look at the other, and then within their own hearts, a shadow of betrayal swept through the room. Were they capable of such a thing? Saddened, one by one, they questioned him. "Lord, is it I?" As Jesus broke the bread and poured the wine, the shadow of sacrifice weighed heavily upon his heart. And he told them, "This is my body broken for you, and this is my blood spilled for your sins. Eat, drink, and remember." And they sang a hymn and went out.
Now our music reflections turn us to the cross. The scene played out at the cross of Christ is one we've been considering all throughout Lent this year, and it's a scene which, despite its foreignness to us in our day, was one that played out thousands of times before Jesus experienced his cross. Friends and family looked on as their loved one was executed. It was the way of an occupying force to exert its authority. And the Romans were exceptional. They would allow all sorts of people to gather because this was a public spectacle. Under the cross, we find a mix of humanity. You have the executioner and the guards, the gamblers, all of the bystanders, all of the loved ones, the friends, the disciples, Jesus' own mother, all were there at this crossroad that the Romans intended to show as an example to those who would die in such a public place. Crucifixion was a humiliation and warning to others. Yet as much as this scene had been played out 1,000 times before and in all sorts of different ways, on this day, we're drawn to remember the death of one man and one cross. We come to stand under this cross. And in doing so, to understand what happened in that moment and to understand the death of this man, Jesus, to understand the meaning of our lives and the meaning of death and the meaning of hope in the eternal, the meaning of God, all summed up in the cross of Christ. We Christians have spent 2,000 years theologizing and reflecting, trying to understand the puzzle that the cross presents, understand the concepts that we've talked about these last 6 weeks, concepts like suffering and atonement, concepts of God's reconciliation and the theology of God's love presented through the sacrifice of the cross, all occurring on the cross. And it's not surprising we do this. We have deep questions. And the gospel writers wrote the gospels in ways that we needed to grapple with the mystery and some of the deep truths that the cross of Christ presents. And yet on that day, standing under Jesus' cross, I hardly doubt that Jesus' loved ones cared about theology. That Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and John, the beloved disciple, they just watched their loved one die. It was a very human experience. And so I doubt that they were worrying about the theological implications of the event. Instead, in that moment, they beheld the pain and the suffering of their Lord and of their friend. And they wanted to comfort him. They wanted to be with him in his final hours and final minutes, probably wondering why the sheer brutality of the experience could occur to this man, this Lord, our Lord, Jesus Christ. Maybe even wondering about their own mortality, that they may be found out by being present at the scene. They were human after all. So friends, we stand under the cross this night and we hear and reflect on the work of Jesus Christ on the cross, revealing God's extravagant love. And we know that death is not the last word, that there is more to come, that there's hope for reconciliation with God. Jesus' own prayer shows us as much when he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." God is reaching out in grace towards humanity. God is showing through Jesus his love enfleshed. And here on the cross of Christ is the culmination of God's story that we find in the scriptures, a story of a God who pursues humanity in love to the very own at the cost, to the very end at the cost of his very son. Tonight, friends, we stand under the cross. And we look up. What do we see? What do you see? As much as there may be about Jesus' death, all of the implications, all the theological understandings, and what is occurring, one thing I know to be true, and that is that the gospel writers were intent to let us know of God's deep love for his son, Jesus Christ, and his deep love for you and me, his children. Those of us who are made in God's image and made to be in community with one another, we stand under the cross. We look up. What do we see? What do you see? Let us pray. Holy God, the hosannas have died away and the palm branches have turned brittle. And now today there is only this. Each of us, all of us, sitting in the darkness of tonight with our hymns of lament, our hearts are heavy. What is good about this Good Friday? What is good about our Lord being nailed to a cross? And yet you, Lord, are good. When we suffer in despair, we remember that you were there first, peering into the abyss of death and crying out incredibly, Father, forgive them. And when we feel forgotten or forsaken, we remember that in your last moments, you cared for your mother, you cared for your beloved disciple, and you bound them together as a new family like you would the church. When we feel overcome by guilt, Lord, we remember that you spoke grace to a thief by saying, today you will be with me in paradise. Your love for us is just and boundless and ever-present and extravagant and good. Thank you, Lord. What else can we say here in the dimness and in the darkness of this night? But thank you. Amen.
Darkness took its final hold on Judas as he left the upper room. That night in Gethsemane, Jesus, burdened with sorrow, prayed alone. The shadows continued to lengthen. In that place of solitude and solace, a place Jesus loved, Judas returned. He brought with him those to whom he had sold not only his teacher, but himself. The final affront came. He betrayed the Lord with a kiss, and the soldiers led Jesus away. Fleeing in fear, the disciples abandoned him, and he was left in the shadow of loneliness. Darkness reigned. And it was night.
Thank you.
the soldiers bound Jesus and handed him over to Pilate. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. Silent as a sheep before its shearers, he stood in the shadow of suffering and said, "Not a word."
The world loved darkness
rather than light. And in the shadow of the cross, light and darkness came face to face. Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Grant us peace. The light of the world became obedient, even in the shadow of death. The sun hid its rays as the Father looked away, and darkness shrouded the earth. Creation groaned and wept as her Creator died.